Big East matchup, he said, comes your way from Pittsburgh, where the Panthers play host to Boston College. Hello, everyone, and welcome. I'm Sean McDonough, and it's great to have you with us. Admittedly, these two teams have had disappointing seasons. They have similar problems, most notably the loss of their starting point guard for the year due to injury. Jerry McCullough of Pitt, Chris Heron of Boston College, not involved in the programs this year. As a result, lots of turnovers, and these two teams are at the bottom of the Big East standings. I'm joined tonight by Derek Dickey. Derek, there are some bright spots beneath the clouds for these two teams. Daniel Abrams of Boston College, Jaime Peterson of Pitt have been terrific.
Well, Daniel Abramson has been the model of consistency for Boston College. You see his numbers the last three games, 29 points each game, 11 rebounds almost every game, and he's been a stabilizing force down on the block. The other guy, Jaime Peterson, has continued to improve his game every single game this year. Almost 10 points better this year versus last, almost 6 rebounds better, and he gets to the free throw line. We're going to take a look at what this banging is going to take place down on the block.
We expect a fun game to watch tonight. Each team will try to trap out of their half-court defenses, and we expect a number of three-point attempts. Boston College and Pittsburgh, in a moment. Welcome back to Fitzgerald Fieldhouse on the campus of the University of Pittsburgh. Second meeting of the season between these two teams. Boston College won the first at home for Coach Jim O'Brien. The big part of the Eagles' victory in the first meeting with Pitt was Mark Malinsky, who scored a career-high 23 points. He's a three-point specialist. For Ralph Willard, a depleted roster, only 7 scholarship players active at the moment. And his big gun in the first meeting with BC was Orlando Antigua, like Malinsky. Antigua had 23 points in the game at the Conti Forum. That game won 74-69 by BC. And Ralph Willard told his team at the workout this morning, you have to know where Malinsky is at all times.
Absolutely. He comes off the bench, and what he's going to do, Malinsky is a great spot-up shooter. He will try to put the ball on the floor occasionally, but you still have to know where he is. So Pitt is going to play a little bit of zone this evening, some matchup, and also try to force the ball out of the hands of Malinsky.
Pitt's played a lot of 1-3-1 zone this year, and Ralph Willard said that Boston College did the best job of any team that they've played this year against the 1-3-1. So as a result, we might see a 3-2 zone look from the Panthers that has matchup principles. Underway, BC control the opening tip.
You mentioned the similarities between these teams, Sean, and what it is they both look diagonal for the pass. They'll get some easy layups just like that, but also they want to trap and pressure out front.
Keenan Jordan with the first bucket of the game, like Mark Malinsky. Jordan's been coming on of late. And the Eagles off to a quick 2-0 lead. Andre Allridge guarded by Dwayne Woodward. Both figured to be backups when this year started, but as we noted, Jerry McCullough out for Pitt for the year with a knee injury suffered before the season. Chris Heron, one of the most highly recruited high school players in the country last year, would have been the starting point guard for BC. He went down in the first game with a wrist injury that required surgery. And these teams have had trouble adjusting. Jordan missed it in close. Abrams was fouled. He noted it in the warm-up. He ought to change his number to 29 with 29 points in each of the last three games for Danier. There is Jerry McCullough, who is back working out. We saw him doing extra work with Tom Crean, one of the assistant coaches today, and that's the kind of production that he gave the Panthers last year. Ralph Miller said without question he would have been one of the best point guards in the country this year. He'll be back for his senior year next year. With 29 points in each of his last three, Abrams up to 21 per game for his season average. Just behind Ray Allen at the top of the Big East scoring pile. And it's no surprise he got to the line either. He leads the conference in free throw attempts, now 165. He made both, and BC leads 4-0.
Abrams gets to the free throw line about 8, sometimes 9 times a game. So it's going to be important for Pitt not to lose him when the ball goes up on the offensive boards.
Chris Gant.
Matchup zone now being played by Boston College. They're going to try to come out and extend the defense of Pitt a little bit higher, let them take the threes, but also crash down.
Sproul was stripped by Abrams, and the Eagles look to push it. They do to Hrabowski. He missed the reverse layup. Peterson took it off the glass. Just as Ralph Willard's going to try to surprise BC with his 3-2 matchup zone, Jim O'Brien said he'd try to give Pitt this 1-3-1 look and then have his team match up out of it in the man-to-man.
Exactly. Switch defenses and don't let the offense get comfortable with seeing one particular style. And I think what Pitt wants to do is get the ball down inside to Jaime Peterson and try to get him some offense early.
Aldridge, awkward shot with the shot clock down to 5 seconds, held ball, and Pitt will inbound. And already some hostilities and the officials quickly intervene. Mike Kitts, Bob Donato, John Cal, the trio of officials. These two teams, the bottom two in terms of turnover margin in the Big East this season. That's the biggest reason why Pitt is in last place with one conference win and BC just ahead of them with two league victories.
We always talk about how important it is to maintain possession of the ball, but when you average 20-plus turnovers a game, that takes the ball out of your hand for possessions, just like that one.
Monty Sproul, a walk-on, now in the starting lineup. Knocked in a three for the first points for the Panthers. It took them more than 2 minutes to score. No room for Malinsky.
Nice extension on the defense by Pitt. They're forcing BC out a little bit further.
Jordan has it rattle out, rebounded by Gant. That's his strong suit. 4-3 Boston College, 17-20 remaining in the first half.
It's going to be important for Pitt to have good spacing out here against this matchup zone. Continue to try to work the ball around the perimeter and let everybody touch it.
Aldridge was fouled on the drive by Dwayne Woodward. Not only was it unexpected that these two would see considerable minutes this year, now they play all the minutes. Aldridge and Woodward, the Ironman, interesting line in a recent newspaper story in Pittsburgh about Aldridge, that for the first 2 years here at Pitt, he couldn't get off the bench. Now he can't get off the floor.
Playing almost 39 minutes a game. That's an awful lot for a guy who wasn't expected to play at all. But being a major factor in the offense, and coaches will argue, do you take a center first if you're starting a team, or do you take a point guard? Give me a point guard, someone who can make his teammates better.
Sproul was deflected up high by Woodward. Sproul thought he was fouled. Still 4-3 BC, and then Sproul commits the reach-in foul at the other end. Sproul's a junior. He tried out as a walk-on the last 2 years while Paul Evans was the coach, but never made the team. This season, the first for Pitt under Ralph Willard, Sproul made the club as a walk-on, and now he's a starter.
Made some pretty significant contributions as that walk-on against Villanova. He had 9 points and 10 rebounds.
Pass went right through the hands of Hrabowski. And the turnover plagued Eagles commit another. Jason Mayle. Excellent three-point shooter. Checked in for Sproul.
For those that remember Ralph Willard at Western Kentucky, he liked to pressure full court, had full court presses and traps, and under the Rick Pitino philosophy, shoot a lot of threes. He said coming here this year, he doesn't feel he has the athletes to be able to do that.
Doesn't have enough of them. Only seven scholarship players on the active roster. The strip by Antigua. He missed from in close. Gant drops it in, and the Panthers have their first lead.
That's great hustle by the Pittsburgh Panthers to stay after that loose ball. And Gant, being a senior out of Houston, Texas, shows a lot of experience at 6'7", almost 250 pounds.
Hrabowski, senior tri-captain from Detroit. He's a three-point threat if they leave him all alone. Hrabowski off the bullet pass from Jordan, and the Eagles go back up by one.
That's a nice job by Keenan Jordan to get that dribble penetration, to get inside the seam of the defense, force him to commit to you, then look for the kick out.
That's how much the injury to Heron has hurt Boston College. As Jim O'Brien says, where else in America would you find a player who is the starting four man as Keenan Jordan is at power forward? Time to time he goes in to play point guard. Point guard and power forward. Mail the pull-up, nicely done. Panthers by one at 7-6. We've played more than 5 minutes here in Pittsburgh.
Well, Jason Mayo didn't score but 1 point in 5 minutes of play in the first meeting between these two clubs, so he's going to have to start looking. He's just a sophomore. Get some confidence and look for that shot.
Malinsky sneaks along the baseline, rebounded by Mayo. He took a little bump from Abrams. Antigua stepping on the line, missed a two-point try, and the long carom out to Rabowski.
So far, both teams have taken pretty good care of the ball. They haven't forced a lot of turnovers.
Nice pass by Woodward to Abrams. You can see Woodward improving as the year goes along. It was thought this year he'd be a backup player. Really was a combination guard in high school, not a true point guard. They thought they could ease him into the program. Instead, they had to throw him into the fire. And given the circumstances, he's done admirably. Mail the miss, kept alive by Jordan. Now Peterson trying to power in. Abrams held his ground. And Rabowski slapped the arm of Chris Gann.
We talked about the banging going to take place between the Abrams and Peterson down on the block. Peterson comes up with the offensive rebound. Couldn't get the stick back because Donye Abramson held his ground.
First foul on Rabowski, second on the team. Timeout on the floor. Boston College leads 8-7.
Boston College wants to get the ball inside as quickly as they can, and the best way to do that against pressure is by trying to get some dribble penetration. You're going to see Keenan Jordan make a dribble right between and split the defense. Come from the weak side. If you have a weak side cutter, you got a chance to get that defense to commit to the ball, make the pitch off, and get an easy layup inside. Excellent ball movement, good pass, nice execution.
And Jim O'Brien. Got high marks from Ralph Willard, as we mentioned today, for how well prepared his team was to face the Panthers in the first meeting of the Connie Forum. 8-7 BC, 13 and a half minutes remaining in the first half. Allridge for three. He leads the team in three-pointers made. That's his 44th of the year. And the Panthers as a team average nearly 8 three-pointers made per game, second in the conference behind Villanova.
Aldridge is going to open up the inside for Peterson. He's got to look for that outside shot.
Blocked shot by Peterson. His 51st of the year, and then Aldridge threw it away with a Woodward. Woodward had Malinsky, instead went for the tough layup and converted. And the Eagles have tied it up at 10-10.
That was a tough layup, but if Dwayne Woodward gives the ball up right away, you got a chance for an uncontested layup as opposed to trying to make a circus shot.
They leave Gant alone. He drills a three. Just the second three-pointer made by Gant this year. He's now 2 of 8 for the season. You can understand why BC left him alone.
Let's keep an eye on the next time down the floor. If Jaime Peterson's able to get some freedom down on the block now that Pitt's starting to look for that outside shot a little bit.
And now that they're knocking them in. 12-15 left in the half. Jordan. Stepped on the end line. And we've played 8 minutes, and BC really has had a tough time finding Donye Abrams in the half court.
They have had a tough time because of Pitt extending the defense out high and also contesting the basket, not letting Abrams get a clean look at the ball handler out front.
Each team has turned it over three times. Pitt now 3 out of 5 from three-point range. Aldridge lost it on the dribble.
That's what you and I were talking about this morning, the part that both the ball handling guards are going to have to be very careful bringing the ball up the floor, because if they're not, they're going to turn it over because of the pressure.
Saw the numbers posted by Ralph Willard at Western Kentucky in the NCAA tournament the last 2 years, and he says this should be an easier job in terms of turning the program around than it was at Western Kentucky, and that's saying a lot given in his third year at Western. He had them ranked 16th in the country. Jordan followed up his own miss with another miss. Abrams.
Strong. Very, very strong. Attacking the offensive glass. Donye Abrams, he's averaging 21 points and 9 rebounds a game.
Under 12 minutes remaining. First half. Pitt by one. Pitt comes in having lost five in a row. They were throttled in their last game 9 days ago in Storrs, Connecticut by UConn, 90-61. Ralph Willard said the 9-day layoff came at an excellent time. Garrett Thomas with his first points. And Pitt leads by three. And a whistle. Peterson might be having a contact lens problem. He is.
Donye Abrams going to be working down on the boards. Watch number 24 as he taps the ball up and keeps it alive to himself. Nice strong move, great body, good presence in the finish.
Saw lead.
And perhaps the Razorbacks are kicking it into high gear as the NCAA tournament approaches and they think about defending their title. Donye Abrams, the only returning starter from last year's BC club that went to the Elite Eight. The other four starters, Rod Abram, Malcolm Huckabee, Howard Isley, and Bill Curley have all gone on to play professional basketball. Bill Curley's brother, Mickey Curley, just into the game, traveled along the end line. And Abrams, last year a role player, this year counted upon to be the main gun. And as a result, his numbers have gone way up.
All that stepping up a little bit, stepping up his game, especially being a lot more aggressive and going after the ball. Offensively, likes the offensive glass and will rebound the ball.
Panthers are hitting their threes. Garrett Thomas rattled one in. He has five and nearly midway through the half. Pittsburgh has its largest lead, 6 points at 18-12.
Pitt's able to hit that outside shot. It's going to open up things a lot more inside. They shoot about 34% from behind the stripe.
Walensky, they're defending him at the three-point line, so he took it to the basket and got fouled. Triple header tomorrow night on ESPN. First at 7:30 Eastern. It's the second-ranked North Carolina Tar Heels taking on Clemson. And it's out to the Pac-10 for a pair of games. 9:30 Eastern, number 12, Arizona visits USC. Then following SportsCenter, midnight Eastern time, Arizona State. Now number 13 taking on number 6 UCLA tomorrow night, all right here on ESPN. Walensky, an excellent free throw shooter, made the first.
Walensky, the last five games, is another player. He's averaging 7 points and only 2 rebounds per game on the season. Last five games, 13 points and 4 rebounds a game. A great standing shooter who has to start looking to penetrate a little bit more.
Pitt by five, midway through the half.
This kind of pressure, 2-3 zone, you make a skip pass or a good ball fake, you can get the open shot.
They are sizzling from behind the line. 5 out of 7 from three-point range are the Panthers. They've used the bomb to open up an 8-point lead. They hit 10 three-pointers, but still lost in the first meeting against BC. Abrams off the feed from Woodward. Abrams has 8 of the 15 Boston College points.
Abrams has great hands when it comes to the ball around the basket. Last year against Providence, had 20 rebounds against Michael Smith and Dickie Simpkins.
Thomas a bit too frisky, following up the 3-point miss by Mail. He went over the back of Danier and committed his second foul, the fourth against the Panthers. Antonio Granger, a freshman who's really been coming on of late from Boston College, is into the game. We saw him last Wednesday night here on ESPN, and in 20 minutes in that game against Georgetown, he had a double-double, 12 points, matching his career high and a career-best 10 rebounds.
Excellent score once he gets the ball in his hands. High school, 28 points, 13 rebounds a game.
He's from Detroit. Down to 13 on the shot clock. Woodward tried to force it in and got away with it. It got deflected to Abrams. He has 10.
A lot of people talk about Corliss Williamson with Velcro hands, being able to have the ball stick to his hands. Danye Abramson is doing a terrific job with finding the seam and coming up with loose balls.
Ballridge, another three for Pitt. They're sixth. And they lead by 7 points.
could say it's a great start for Ralph Wheeler's ball club. They only shoot about 41% from the field inside the stripe. Long range, we just mentioned 34%, but tonight they're burning up the court.
6 out of 9 from three-point land, and the Eagles haven't been able to get Malinsky open for a three-point try.
Well, it's going to take some good diagonal passes. Pitt's playing the passing lane extremely well.
Woodward stepped in and drew the charge. Fine defense by Dwayne Woodward. Jason Mayle committed the offensive foul.
Mayle was a little out of control on this play, trying to get up court with nowhere to go.
First foul on Mayle. We'll be back in a moment.
Pitt's trying to do a much better job of faking the ball left or right, or make a skip pass. You're going to see Jason Mayle right here in the center of your screen. He's going to fake to the left, fake to the right, and force the defense to move with him. When they don't commit, that's when he's going to look at the basket. Only when the defender drops off enough to give him a clearance, he's able to cash in that shot. But it's nice ball movement by Pitt, because all they want to do is try to get the defense to step off at least one or two steps, get a clean look at the hoop.
Panthers with a 7-point lead on the strength of 6 of 9 from three-point range, and 5 different Panthers have hit a three-point shot. Danny Abrams up to his old tricks, but his team is down 7 and without the ball after the turnover. They're 6th.
We're seeing an example of what offense has done to trigger the defensive aggressiveness and intensity of Pittsburgh.
Jaime Peterson. His first points.
We talked earlier in the game what would happen if Pitt's able to make that outside shot. It's only going to open up opportunities inside for Jaime Peterson to get some layups and some easy dunks.
Mickey Curley was open, but Woodward didn't have enough on the pass. Antigua short from three-point range, and Woodward able to control along the end line. Pitt has its largest lead, 9 points, 7-10 remaining in the first half. John McDonough with Derek Dickey. Nice crowd here at Fitzgerald Fieldhouse. Malinsky finally gets open for a three, and he connected. He has 4 points.
When you have a guy that shoots 42% behind the stripe, you want to get the ball in his hands, but it's going to take some distraction. You're going to have to move the ball to the opposite side of the court, then make a dribble penetration or a skip pass and try to get Mark Malinsky involved.
Malinsky, also an outstanding student this week, named to the District 1 All American Academic Team. And he becomes a candidate for National All American Honors on the academic squad. Aldridge knocks home another from the outside. His third three-pointer answered by a stuff by Granger.
Well, whenever a team applies pressure, especially full court, if the ball handler makes a good fake and gets to the center of the court, it gives you options. You have a chance to either attack the basket or make a dump pass down inside.
They lob it into Peterson. He had the size advantage over Malinsky on the catch, and he scored. And the Panthers match their largest lead at 9.
Saw Jason Peterson kind of fade away from the basket on that play. You want him to take it to the hoop and try to get to the free throw line.
First foul on Jaime Peterson. Ralph Wheeler didn't like it. Looked like a pretty clean play coming from behind Abrams.
Didn't see a lot of contact over the back, but Jaime has to be careful. He's been known to get in a little foul trouble. He's fouled out of 6 games this season.
Paul Grant in at 6'10 for Mickey Curley.
Can't quite pick the ball up, but take a look at the back. See if the bodies meet. I didn't see much contact on that play.
Looks like a clean play. 16 fouls on Pitt. Grant, travel.
I think BC's trying to rush the ball just a little bit, not showing enough patience. You got 35 seconds to be able to look for a good shot. Yeah, you want to get that dribble penetration, but you also want to try to get the best shot.
8 turnovers for Boston College. Antigua, nice shot from the foul line. And Pitt has a double-digit lead, their largest at 11 points, 5:20 left in the first half.
Orlando Antigua is such an emotional player. If he makes a basket or a steal, you're going to see him really jump up and down and get the crowd involved.
They're involved now. Antigua, the dunk And Jim O'Brien wants a timeout. And he is really in the ear of John Cal. Pitt leads in this second meeting of the season with Boston College. Before tonight's game, we talked with Ralph Willard about game one.
I think Jimmy's kids play very, very hard. They have been prone to turnovers. We turned them over in the first time. We played them 13 times in the first half, but only twice in the second half. So I think we have to do a better job of consistently forcing the pressure and looking to turn them over.
Well, they've been forcing turnovers in the first half. Tonight, 9 BC turnovers. They've struggled with the trapping pressure applied by Pitt. Olinsky fought through a trap. Granger missed him in close. Boy, did Pant get up to contest that shot.
Very close to an offensive basket interference.
13-point lead, the largest for Pitt with 4:40 remaining in the first half. Satiris Agalu is in for Pitt wearing number 23.
BC looks to be content with staying back in that zone. With Pitt making those outside jump shots, I think you have to be concerned and maybe come out and play a little man-to-man.
Peterson well off the mark. Granger the rebound. Jim O'Brien has played almost exclusively zone defense since the Big East conference schedule began because he feels his team just is not quick enough to match up man-to-man with most of their opponents in the conference. Abrams traveled, and that's turnover number 10.
Once again, the pressure by Pitt is starting to cause a lot of problems for BC. It was causing some problems out front for the guards. Now inside.
Pitt has scored 11 points off the first 9 Boston College turnovers. Still Panthers by 13, under 4 remaining in the first half.
I don't think Ralph Willard wants to see Jaime Peterson take those 17-foot jump shots. I know Jaime's getting a little impatient getting the ball in his hands, but that's not the shot you want to take.
Get up.
Patience on this trip for the Panthers. 7 on the shot clock. Aldridge dumped it off for Kant. He wasn't ready for it. Then Paul Grant blocked the shot.
Much better defense by BC, and you cannot allow Pitt to get those second chance looks at the basket.
Abram blocked by Peterson, but a foul call. And that's the second foul on Jaime Peterson.
Look at Danier Abramson looking for the ball. He's calling for it. Get the ball in my hands. Once the ball comes in, take a look at Jaime Peterson. He's going to actually block the shot with his right hand, but there was a little body contact down below to cause that foul.
They actually called it from behind on Satiris Agalu, his first, and Pitt is over the limit. Jason Mayall returns the lineup, and Agalu takes a seat. Mentioned earlier, Abrams number 1 in the conference in free throw attempts. And he capitalizes when he's there. 74% for the year from the line. 3 out of 3 tonight. Keenan Jordan back in for Paul Grant. And Abrams remains perfect from the line. I had to believe 29 points in each of his last 3 games, double-double in each of the last 3. He was not the Big East Player of the Week.
I find that very hard to believe. He did struggle in the last meeting between these two ball clubs. Only 5 out of 14 from the field because of the pressure defense down inside. Played 38 minutes, only 14 points.
Ray Allen of Connecticut, Kerry Kittles of Villanova, the co-players of the week in the Big East. Again, the shot clock down to 5 for Pitt and Antigua. Launched one that was way off. Ahead of the field is Malinsky. Aldridge hustling back, and Malinsky missed the dunk and gets called for hanging
foul
on the rim.
I don't agree with that technical because the defense was following. He had a chance to come down on the feet of the defender, Andre Aldridge.
But I would question that as well.
Yeah, there's too many people underneath the basket. You have a chance. You have the opportunity to grab the rim and protect yourself. But I think Malinsky was certainly upset because he missed the basket completely.
Might have been distracted anticipating contact. And that's why he missed the dunk. Mail made the first. The lead is 12 and 13. Those are the first free throw attempts tonight for Pitt. Jim O'Brien in his ninth season at Boston College, armed with a new five-year contract extension after the success of last year when they went 23-11, made it to the final eight of the NCAA tournament, upset North Carolina and Indiana on their way to the Elite Eight. They lost 70% of their offense from a year ago when that talented senior class departed.
You mentioned Chris Herron, the freshman, who would also have helped this team, had surgery on his left wrist. He's a guy who's a tremendous point guard with a lot of confidence.
And Coach O'Brien feels they would be close to a 500 team in the conference if they had Chris Herron. Coming up with John Saunders and Digger Phelps, highlights from the ACC and the Big Ten. Aldridge with the shot clock running out, missed. Now Woodward pushes with Malinsky. Mail stripped Woodward from behind and could control it inbound. But when they break the pressure, the Eagles, they're getting the advantage in the numbers, but they're not always converting.
Well, Dwayne Woodward tries to take this ball down. He should have given it up. Once again, you got a chance to get it back. But you see how Pitt is struggling from the outside now? They're not rotating the ball. They're not getting dribble penetration.
And a three for Malinsky, his second. He had five in the first meeting between these two teams. Mentioned academic All-American Malinsky, a 3.21 GPA as an accounting major in the Carroll School of Management at Boston College. Now four misses in a row from three-point range for Pitt after starting 6 of 9. They're now 6 out of 13.
You have to move the defense around. That's the key to getting an open jump shot or an uncontested look at the basket. And Pitt has not been doing that lately. They're taking the ball off the dribble, trying to take shots just like that.
Peterson following up the Antigua miss, and it's knocked out of bounds by Boston College. 33 on the shot clock for the Panthers. A minute 17 left in the half.
Pittsburgh!
Is starting to extend their defense just a little bit more, coming out high and not letting Pitt get easy looks at the basket. If they continue with the execution of their offense, run the play and go through, you will have better looks.
Five in a row, off the mark, three-point range for Pitt. Last one fired up by Aldridge, and Hrabowski the strong rebound.
Each one of those five shots had a defender's hand in their face.
Hrabowski thought he was fouled by Peterson as he went on the drive. See the game clock, 40 seconds, and now 25 on the shot clock.
Pitt should try to look inside, maybe get the ball in Jaime Peterson's hands, force the defense to come back in, and then look to pitch it out.
Mail, an open three, and the drought continues from beyond the line, but BC really hasn't been capitalizing. They can hold for the final shot, and it appears they will.
Try to get it under a 10-point lead as the half comes to an end.
Woodward bumped into his own man as he tried to split the defense. They need a shot. Abrams had it blocked. Abrams got it back, and
no basket,
says Mike Kitts. It was ever so close.
Danier Abrams is going to try to get this shot off before the shot clock expires. He actually gets it blocked by Jaime Peterson, but he stays with it and tries to get it back. Unable to get the shot off before the clock ends. They have to go into the locker room down by 10.
37-27 in favor of Pitt. Now let's join John Saunders with the Delta Fawcett halftime report.
All right, Sean and Derek, thanks a lot, along with Digger Phelps here. It's interesting, a couple of teams at the bottom of the Big East, but they've given other teams at the top fits this year.
I think Pitt, Boston College, as well as Miami are going to be spoilers in a Big East tournament.
Yeah, guys at the top might beware come March when they gather at Madison Square Garden. We'll continue with more in just a moment here on the Delta Fawcett Halftime Report. Look at some scores and highlights, including Arkansas in action in conference against Alabama, looking for some revenge. They knocked them off the first time. Back with that and more in a moment.
ESPN's NCAA Basketball, brought to you by Buick, makers of the concept car you can drive, the 1995 Riviera, and by State Farm Insurance. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Thank you, John. Evan, Iowa State pulling on some tough times after a fast start. Pittsburgh by 10 at halftime here at Fitzgerald Fieldhouse. And that's despite another solid half from Danier Abrams.
Well, Danier had to get involved with the offense. Wasn't getting the ball down on the block, so he steps out to the free throw line, gets it, and takes it all the way to the basket. He's got 12.7 rebounds in the first half. And Pittsburgh, they're shooting 44% from behind the stripe. But in order to get more open shots, you got to get dribble penetration, skip passes. You can get those open looks at the basket.
And a big part of the success for Pitt in the first half, the three-point shooting. They were 7 of 16. They lead by 10. The largest lead was 13. Hrabowski guarded by Antigua. Jordan strong to the bucket for two. Had to alter his shot as he got in close and still made it. Keenan Jordan has 4 points.
Excellent job by Keenan Jordan, who recognized the one-on-one defense. Pitt went away from the zone. They were playing the first half. Got a chance to get a little bit of dribble on the baseline for the easy layup.
Thomas Aldridge, Peterson, Gant, and Antigua open the half, and it's Gant who dropped it in for the first Pitt points of the second half. 5 points in the game for Chris Gant.
Nice recognition by Aldridge at the top of the key with the dribble, keeping his dribble alive.
Malinsky got open for a couple of threes in the first half. That got deflected right to Abrams, and he scores. He has 14 on his way to another double-double. It would be his fourth in a row and 11th of the season in 21 games. So he can corral three more rebounds.
Offensive foul. Chris Gant.
First foul on either team here in the second half.
Bucks number 40, Chris Gant. He's going to run right into Danier Abrams right on the baseline. And yes, that was a foul. Nice call.
Some confusion at the table as to whom the foul was charged.
The foul was called on number 24, Danier Abrams, at Boston College.
Now they're saying it was on Danier Abrams. I think they meant to call it on Gant, but Mike Kitts, the official, and I saw him walk to the table and say 2-4, but he pointed the other way as it was offensive foul. Now he doesn't know who's.
Take another look at it. Abrams is just standing there, and Gant runs right into him, initiating the contact.
Oh, if Mike Kitts called it on the wrong person and forgot when he got to the table, I think, which Pitt player was on. Now they've called it on Abrams. That's just miserable.
That is not a good call.
Oh, that's atrocious.
That's when you have to have a consultation of the officials and come up with the right decision.
I mean, he points offensive foul. Clearly was Gant, if it was worthy of a foul at all. He was the one who committed the foul.
No question.
That's just atrocious.
See if that foul has an outcome on the final result of this game.
Jim O'Brien says to Mike Kitts, you blew it big time, and I'd have to go with the coach on that one.
No question. See if Pitt tries to get the ball inside a little bit more. Get it down on the block.
Peterson missed from in close, and Jordan kept it alive. Boston College down 8 with the ball. Minute and a half played in the second half. Malinsky to Woodward. He doesn't shoot much.
An aggressive play on the zone by Pitt. They're trying to force BC to move out just a little bit further than where they want to receive it.
And Malinsky way beyond the line. Buries a three. His third. He has 10 points in double figures again for Boston College. And the Eagles have cut that halftime deficit in half. They were down 10. It's now 5 with 17:50 left.
Malinsky's starting to warm up a little bit. He's now in double figures with 10 points in this game.
Antigua. Lando's brother Oliver is a manager on this team and has also played as a walk-on. They turn it over again. Gantz had it poked away by Abrams in the low post. Hrabowski traveled. Wasn't sure to shoot, pass, or drive. Started to drive, but he had already taken a couple of steps.
You have to make a decision as soon as the ball comes into your hand. Don't make the decision before you get it.
Bevan Thomas sees his first action, number 4. He was a starter earlier in the year, but of late hasn't played much. Many of his minutes have gone to Malinsky and Keenan Jordan. He's a sophomore from Hyde Park, Massachusetts, who sat out last year as a transfer from Boston University. Only had to move about 2 miles along Commonwealth Ave as he went from BU to BC. Derek Thomas. Antigua thought he was going to shoot that three, and he went heading for a rebound, and Thomas threw it away. And Ralph Willard has seen enough of this. He wants a timeout. It's a 5-point game here in Pittsburgh.
Hey, look, it's the new Pontiac Sunfire. Now, if you take yours dog sledding in the Yukon, all that interior room means, for once, your sled dogs won't argue about who gets in front. Or if you take your new Pontiac Sunfire zipping over to that pizza place, the sport suspension and high revving engine mean you'll really enjoy driving it at full tilt. Finally, a real set of wheels for around 12.5, the all-new Pontiac Sunfire.
It's a land like no other, with a beer like no other. Molson Ice. Ice brewed by North America's oldest brewery to be colder and bolder. Yet smooth as ice. Molson Ice, from the land where ice was born.
I'm sorry, I'm never going to get into a sport that's played with the broom.
It's called curling.
It's called cleaning the basement. I'm out of here. I'm going to McDonald's.
You know what your problem is?
What?
You're afraid to try something new, Jerry.
Excuse me, Mr. Fun with Cleaning Utensils? I am. I'm going to try the new Patty McMelt.
McDonald's new Patty McMelt. Your favorite quarter pound of beef with grilled onions, melted American cheese, savory Canadian-style bacon, and tempting Swiss cheese sauce, but only for a limited time.
So what's your next sport going to be? Vacuum cleaner hockey?
What was I thinking?
Pittsburgh by 5, and here in the Berg, they're talking about hockey, the NHL. And those Pittsburgh Penguins are on ESPN Sunday night at 8 as they take on Alexander Mogilny, the Buffalo Sabres. Penguins are 11-0-1. Jaromir Jagr's hat trick yesterday gives him an NHL high 13 goals for the season, but he'll be up against the best goalie in the NHL, Dominik Hasek, who's allowing only 1.43 goals per game. Buffalo and Pittsburgh Sunday night, National Hockey Night, 8 p.m. Eastern. Here on ESPN. We went to Pittsburgh today. Folks, we're talking about the Gwynns. Another turnover by BC. They had a chance to pull even closer. They've got the deficit down to 5 for a crowd of 6,719, just under capacity, less than 100 below capacity. And that's terrific fan support given the position of these teams in the standings.
I don't believe Chris Gantz saw the basket on that last shot attempt. Danier Abrams was all over him.
And Abrams had a Panther all over him at the offensive end. Gantz bucket made it a 7-point lead. And the foul was on Gantz, his first. And the first charge for the Panthers, sort of.
Sort of.
Sort of. They were given a mulligan earlier in the half. Bevan Thomas missed after he made a nice move to get three, but Abrams there to clean up the mess. And the Eagles back within 5.
And he's coming up with another rebound stick back, and BC is slowly creeping back in this game by not allowing Pitt to get the ball across half court and also not allowing them to get second chance three passes.
Wow, great range on that three-pointer from Garrick Thomas, the junior from Houston. His brother Marcus, sophomore guard at UConn, the number one team in the country. And of course, the Connecticut women are number one in the nation in women's basketball, and Rebecca Lobo and her mates are here at Fitzgerald tomorrow night to play the Pitt Panthers. Keenan Jordan off a nice feed from Bevan Thomas.
Good strong move and nice job to keep that dribble alive and get it down on the baseline where the defense can't cover two different players.
Hit by six with the ball. 15-38 remaining. Panthers only 3-5 here at Fitzgerald Fieldhouse this year. They've won better than 80% of their games here over the last 10 seasons. And a moving screen. It's on Jaime Peterson up high. And that's his second. Ralph Willard, great story. 8 years ago at age 40, he was a high school coach and athletic director. St. Dominic's on Long Island. Had a very successful printing business on the side. Decided to give up all that security. Bevan Thomas missed a three. Antigua tracks it down. He left all of that to become a volunteer assistant coach under Jim Boeheim in Syracuse. Left his wife and three children behind in Long Island and went as an unpaid assistant at Syracuse for a year. So he's going to give himself 5 years to become a college head coach. Gant scored inside. Well, after stints at the Knicks with Rick Pitino, then on to Kentucky with Pitino. 5 years later, he was the head coach at the collegiate level at Western Kentucky. And now he's one of the hottest coaches in the country. Abrams was pushed. After last season, Willard, courted by Providence and Pittsburgh. Talked that he was courted by Tennessee as well. And it was expected by just about everyone that he was going to Providence. But chose Pitt, a move that surprised many who followed the Big East. Not that he chose Pitt, just that it seemed it was a done deal that he was heading for Providence. Heading for the basket, the Eagles again, another foul. The fourth against the Panthers here in the second half. That one against Antigua, his second. Jason Mayall in for Garrick Thomas.
And Ralph Willard's story should let people know that regardless of what your goals are, if you set them, you have a chance to achieve them if you just stay with it. Continue to stay with it, work with it. There are people who will work with you.
Abrams 4-4 from the line tonight. And still perfect. Try to make it a six-point game if he can make the second with 14:40 left. One more rebound, and it's the fourth consecutive double-double for Danier. He missed a free throw. Jordan, great hustle. Couldn't keep it alive for BC.
Pitt needs a basket here. They've been a little stagnant coming out this second half. They need to start looking to try to get maybe some dribble penetration, maybe a couple of skip passes, and then look down on the block, hopefully get the ball in the hand of Jaime Peterson.
And they throw it away through the hands of Antigua. And you wonder if this Pitt team has a psychological stumbling block to overcome in that they've played so many close games. And they really should be better than 1-11 in the conference, the number of close games in which they've been involved. They've had seven games in the conference of 5 points or less when it's been decided, and they've lost all seven.
It's amazing because there are times when a coach would say, I'll put the ball in the hands of my best player, my best point guard. Ralph Willard has his son, Kevin, sitting on the bench who is ineligible this year, but a player he would like to have handle the ball at the end of the game, or even a Jerry McCullough who's injured. You get a player like that who has some experience and some game savvy, and you have a chance to win some of those 4, 5, 6, 7 point games down the stretch.
Teams matching each other turnover for turnover at the moment. DC with the ball down seven, just under 14 minutes remaining. Malinsky, a little bit long from three-point range. And the long carom was tracked down by Bevan Thomas.
DC being a lot quicker to the ball this second half, be it a loose ball, be it offense and defensive rebounds.
Another three-point try, that rattled out for Bevan Thomas. Abrams was fouled. That's his 10th rebound of the night, another double-double for Danier Abrams.
The Pittsburgh foul, number 21.
Follow Danier Abrams, number 24 on your screen. He's moving inside. Whoa. He takes a little right cross by Jaime Peterson. Nothing serious, no blood.
A little face rake. Would have made the WWF proud. Certainly Jaime's mother is proud. He asked us to say hello to his mother, Luz, back in New York City. Peterson is originally from the Dominican Republic.
Abrams listed at 6'7", 265, he's pretty close to, I'd say he's a biscuit or two away from about 280. But
he has flirted with 300 in the past.
Got to be careful because he looks like he has the kind of body that could balloon up. But if he takes care of himself, works hard this summer, I think we're going to see a guy who's going to set this Big East Conference on its ear next year.
I think what he's accomplishing this year is so much more impressive when you consider he's really the only big threat that concerns the other team when they line up to play BC.
Absolutely. And in order to complement him, BC's got to get scoring from the outside. They got to have a guy like Malinsky look to shoot the ball, but it helps to have a point guard who can penetrate and create those opportunities, those open shots.
Good movement on the perimeter. Mayo almost got stuck in the air. Aldridge missed a three. Can't the offensive rebound. And he was fouled. Jordan was reaching in. And a technical has been called. Devin Thomas and Garrick Thomas, no relation, pushing and shoving. And John Cal called at least one technical.
See, it's getting a little physical inside. Take a look and see what happens. It's number four. You're going to see the push from behind by Bevin Thomas. Good ball movement, nice offensive rebound by Chris Gant, but on the opposite side, the right-hand corner of your screen, we lost it there in the picture. But
oh, we saw Thomas, Bevin Thomas, give Antigua a shove, and that looked like Antigua slapped at Bevin Thomas. Look at the middle of your screen now. You're looking for the numbers 4 and 44. There they are, pushing and shoving. Now, they're both John, and if there's only one technical, apparently, the way John Cal was pointing. The officials have both coaches at midcourt. The personal foul was on Danier Abrams, his second, third on the team. And neither coach seems particularly pleased with the explanation.
It sounded like Bevin Thomas and Orlando Tigua are both going to receive technical fouls.
They were the original combatants who were shoving and slapping. Donald Foyle, a triple-double tonight for Colgate, and the Red Raiders win over Bucknell in Hamilton, New York.
10 blocks.
Officials still conferring, and the coaches are still perplexed.
Coaches and the officials, they're trying to decide who's going to shoot the free throw.
I think if there are technicals, based on what we saw, they should be against each team.
No question.
Gant is going to shoot free throws for the original foul on Abrams.
And both teams shoot free throws, or nobody shoots free throws.
They announced technicals on Orlando Antigua and Bevin Thomas. Gant made the first. He's a 66% free throw shooter. Teammates call him Country. That's his nickname. He has a Texas accent from Houston. As his nickname Country and a Panther head tattooed on his left upper arm. And you saw earlier Orlando Antigua also has the Panther tattoo on his left shoulder. There they are, side by side.
Seeing more and more students with these tattoos on their body. I'm not a fan of them. I mean, you got any, Sean?
No. I think Dennis Rodman has enough for all of us.
I think he does, too.
Well, I'd like to have his hair, regardless of what color it was.
You just want the crown on top.
Yeah, I'd take even if it was the cranberry or the teal or whatever. I'd just like to have it. Mail made both technical free throws for Pittsburgh. And now Malinsky will shoot two. At the other end, harassed by the crowd. That was in and out. And he got the favorable bounce on the second. We remind you once again, triple header action tomorrow night on ESPN. 7:30 Eastern, North Carolina and Clemson, 9:30 Arizona, USC, midnight Arizona State and UCLA. Lots of the top 25 teams in action tomorrow night here on ESPN. One on alternating possession after the technicals, so Pitt the advantage. 4 points to one in the free throw shooting. And now possession of the ball as well. They push the lead back up to seven. They led by 10 at the half, as many as 13 in the first half. Gant from Mail, and the lead is nine with 12 and a half remaining. 15 points for Chris Gant. And he is six out of seven from the field.
A lot of times a team will get some energy after a technical foul, especially if they're playing on their home court.
Malinsky, nice feed into Abrams. He was triple teamed. Out of bounds off Gant.
He took a shot right in the midsection. Abrams calling. He wants the ball. The mistake he makes, he's got three defenders are on him, and he puts the ball down on the floor, allowing the defense to be able to collapse, and he loses control of it.
Gant is still on the floor, grabbing his right thigh. Let's walk him soft.
To be okay. He's not wincing in pain or anything like that, so I think he's just going to take a little moment and gather himself and get back up on his feet. See if we can see what happens to number 40, Chris Gant in the white. Right there. Looks like he might have taken a knee from Danier Abrams.
And that's a lot of knee.
Number 21, Heidi Peterson.
Appear to be what it is. He's limping off. Doesn't appear, as Derek said, to be in any great pain. And the Eagles inbound. Down by nine again. Cut it down to five. Couldn't get closer than that. Dwayne Woodward doesn't shoot off and missed a three. Rebounded by Antigua. Garrick Thomas passed up the three, and the Panthers set their half-court offense. Thomas went right around Bevan Thomas, then turned it over to Malinsky momentarily. He got it back. Aldridge for three.
I like the patience by Pitt that time. They had a chance for a shot attempt on the baseline, pitched it back out, made another quick skip pass. Andre Aldridge was wide open for that three.
His fourth three-pointer of the night. All of his points have come from the three-point line. He has 12. For those who didn't want to do the math. Garrick Thomas called for the foul. That puts Pittsburgh over the limit. And it's four personals on number four. Kevin Hrabowski back in for Bevan Thomas. Dwayne Woodward will shoot the one and one. Freshman from St. Albans, New York. Waits as Agelu checks in for Thomas. Woodward, a 73% free throw shooter.
Jim O'Brien only has two seniors who get significant time on this basketball team, Kevin Hrabowski and Mark Malinsky. So he wants to try to maximize their abilities while they're on the court, get the ball in their hands, and let them make some of those decisions.
Woodward averages just under 6 points per game at 5.8. He made a pair.
TV timeout.
And a television timeout with 11:29 remaining. Pitt by 10.
Pitt women's gymnastics team.
State Farm presents the rules of the game.
Determining traveling at the end of a dribble is one of the most difficult calls for an official to make. In this play, the player picks up his dribble and moves to the basket. Is it traveling?
When young policyholders come to me, I look at them and think, boy, that was me 15 years ago. I remember very well how quickly things changed for Debbie and me. Marriage, children, our first house. It's exactly why State Farm's family insurance checkups are such a good idea. Your agent helps you put it all in perspective so you can make the right decisions. The way you were 5 years ago is not the way you are today. It's comforting to me when I can say to my policyholders, hey, I've been there.
State Farm is there.
If you said traveling, you were correct. Traveling occurs when a player picks up his pivot foot and puts it back to the floor before releasing the ball.
Rules of the Game has been brought to you by State Farm. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
We looked. We listened. We challenged all conventional thinking. We reconsidered every facet of car design. every nuance of engineering. And at every turn, we not only asked why, we asked, why not? New Dodge Stratus. We questioned everything.
Maryland and Wake Forest, the Terps on the road, looking to stay atop the ACC, but Randolph Childress runs around a little screen and launches a long three, part of an 11-2 run, and Wake leads by 7. We'll keep you updated. Right now, let's take you back to the Big East.
Thank you, John. Here in the Big East, Pitt looking for its second conference win, trying to snap a 5-game losing streak as a 10-point lead, thanks in part to the performance of Andre Aldrich. 4 3-point field goals tonight earlier this season against Georgia down in Atlanta. He had 8 3-pointers on his way to 27 points in that game against the Bulldogs. That's a single game Pitt record for 3-pointers.
And he shoots about 33% on the year from long range and about 32% inside the stripe. So while he's hot, you may as well get the ball in his hand.
Pitt by 10, nearly midway through the second half. Sean McDonough and Derek Dickey at Fitzgerald Fieldhouse in Pittsburgh. These two teams have split their meetings in the regular season the last 2 years, and with a win tonight, Pitt would make it 3 years in a row they've split.
Look for Pitt to make a significant comeback next year. Ralph Willard has what arguably one of the top 5 recruiting classes coming in.
He's been rated a top 5 by several, those who study the recruiting on a national level. Aldrich with the shot clock running down. Rebound Abrams, fouled by Aldrich. Well, they're saying to my kids, I was fouled on my shot. Where was the whistle? First foul on Aldrich, and it's a 1-1 opportunity for Abrams. Boston College has only been called for a total of 5 fouls tonight.
Would you say they've done a good job defensively, playing
yes.
the passing lanes? Not forcing the action, getting the contact.
Jim O'Brien has said defense has really not been the problem for this team this year. It's just been the turnovers. Statistically,
they're doing a solid job statistically.
Every other barometer would say they should be 10-2 in the conference, or at least have a winning record instead of the 2-10 mark. But the turnovers are a killer. When you're minus 7.2 in conference, in turnover margin, you're not going to win many, regardless of whether or not you outshoot the opponents or out rebound them. Chris Gant is back in for Sotiris Agyelou. And another of the Panthers who was injured this year. He had a stress fracture that caused him to miss the first 5 games. Struggled to get it in, then he got it to Aldrich. 2-on-1 with Peterson. Peterson nudged by Abrams, and the foul called.
Just a little finger roll attempt by Jaime Peterson, but the big guy runs the floor well. You're going to see trying to break the pressure that BC's applying to Pitt. Once the ball comes in bounds, you want to try to attack. Andre Aldrich makes a good decision to get the ball to the center of the court. And I'd like to see Jaime Peterson go over the top with that ball. Try to power through the defense and dunk that ball and get to the free throw line with some authority.
Well, that's only the 6th foul called tonight against BC, but 3 of them have been on Abrams. And obviously that's a major concern. He's Boston College's best player.
3 or 3.5 or 2.5?
Yeah, it should be 2. That was one of the all-time mystifiers that we had earlier in the half. Peterson well below his season average, and he's the best free throw shooter in the conference at 82%, another area in which he has improved dramatically over last year. He was in the high 50s.
That's why I like to see him be more aggressive in trying to get the ball down on the block, and then once he gets it, try to make something happen. Go to the basket.
Held ball. BC will retain possession, 24 on the shot clock. Jim O'Brien upset with the rest of his team, not Woodward, that nobody came to help him as he was trying to fight through that double team.
Pitt still trying to trap out of this zone, this half-court matchup zone they're applying.
Woodward penetrated, then gave it to Abrams, who had it batted free. Pitt with the ball up by 10, nearly midway through the second half. Antigua to Gant. solid couple. It's been a tough possession for Pitt in terms of possessing the ball, but Antonio Granger was called for his first foul, and that helped out the Panthers. Five fouls now against the Eagles here in the second half.
Getting into a danger zone for Pitt. They have to start taking better care of the ball. They're averaging 22 and a half turnovers a game.
Jordan got the bounce. Aldridge, the lone defender, and big size advantage for Keenan Jordan at 6'7". He went over Aldridge, listed at 6'1". More than midway through the second half now. Pitt by 8. They led by 10 at the half. Largest lead was 13. Mail in traffic. And it rolls in. Hung on the rim precariously. Jason Mail with 10.
Good entry pass by Jaime Peterson, playing all the way out top. And he makes a pass down and low to get that backdoor layup.
That's three straight games in double figures now for Mail. Peterson called for the bump from behind on Abrams. And that's four on Peterson. So that's a major concern for Pitt, with still 9:16 remaining.
Look at the banging and bumping going on inside between Peterson and Abrams, and it looks like Peterson might have gotten a little bit of a hand or an elbow right in the tooth, and he's going to have to come out with those four personal fouls we mentioned in the first half. He has fouled out of six games so far this year in 20 contests.
Replaced by Garrett Thomas, who also has four fouls. Abrams 1-1. He's 9 out of 10 from the line. Missed the front end. Keenan Jordan. He was fouled and will shoot two. And that's the 10th team foul against Pitt. So BC will shoot two the rest of the way. Foul was on Andre Aldridge, his second.
Keenan Jordan is starting to show some very good athletic ability. We just saw the last basket off the fast break steal that he came up with and getting the finish on that play. And you know, he's really fortunate to be back in the lineup. He missed the last six games of last season with a stress fracture in his left foot. Seems to be healed from that.
And like Mark Malinsky, he has really picked it up lately. The Eagles, a good free throw shooting team. At 71% for the year, and even better than that, 72% in conference. They've missed a couple here lately, and if they're going to make up this 9-point deficit, they'll need to take advantage of the freebie. Mail for three.
Give credit to Andre Aldridge for setting that play up by getting the penetration inside, just enough inside the throat of the defense to force him to come to him. Then you make the pitch out and leave Mail all by himself.
Grabowski threw it away, then Jordan got it back. Keenan Jordan, the man of the moment for Boston College, and he was fouled by Jason Mail. And that's his second, and that'll send Jordan to the line for two. Pitt up by 12. Their largest lead was 13 in the first half for Ralph Willard.
Keenan Jordan to the line to shoot a three-point bonus.
Every time BC starts to creep back in it, they either make a turnover or they give the ball back to Pitt, and Pitt comes back and they score one, two quick baskets and extend that lead back to double digits again.
Jordan's a sophomore from Inglewood, California, Morningside High School in the Los Angeles area. But spent 2 years at Brewster Academy in New Hampshire before coming to BC. He was the student body president at Brewster. Pitt lead is 10 with 8:35 remaining. Aldridge trying to get away from Woodward. We see much more aggressive in their trapping now. Thomas all alone for three. Got it. The Panthers tonight 11 of 21 from three-point range. The big reason why they have the 13-point lead.
They've done a good job with ball movement and getting those open shots.
Grabowski couldn't answer the three. Then Jordan got his hands on it, but couldn't control it. And it's starting to get a bit more desperate for Jim O'Brien's club. With under 8 minutes remaining and a double-digit deficit. Thomas had his pass tipped by Woodward to Malinsky. Hrabowski. Wow. Air ball with the left hand. Abrams, count it.
Boston College, it wants to make a run. They're just not sure how to do it. They're trying to get their baskets in transition. They're struggling in the half court right now. But watch what happens as BC comes up with this loose ball, trying to get it up court, wait for the teammates to give some support, and look at the left-hand throw by Hrabowski just to get the ball up on the glass. But once again, Donye Abrams seems to bail the team out, come up with the loose ball, and stick it back in the hoop.
He converts the three-point play. The foul on Aldridge was his third. It's a 10-point lead for Pitt. Mark on your calendar.
Only Chuckles Comedy Club in Mineola brings you the best in live professional stand-up comedy. And if you mention this ad when calling, you'll receive special discounts to upcoming shows. Chuckles is also a full-service restaurant and bar to ensure you and your guests an evening of fun second to none. So come to where the fun is. Chuckles. It's a blast.
Start off 95 with a bang.
Cape Breton Island. You could spend your whole vacation just looking at the scenery, but don't. To find out more about all the wonderful things you can do on Cape Breton Island, call this toll-free number for your free vacation guide.
You lost them all, but you can still make it to the tournament with the ESPN and Pizza Hut March to the Final Four contest. Pick a team and ESPN will fly you to every tournament game they play. If they lose, forget them. You're still going to the Final Four. To enter, handprint your name, address, age, and home phone number on a 3x5 card and mail it to P.O. Box 2387, Redondo Beach, California, 90278.
Ben, this is the best chance we've had all year.
In a moment.
Maryland and Wake Forest, and the three-pointers are killing the Terps. Randolph Childress drives, dishes out to Rusty LaRue. Not Rusty on the shot, buries it. Three-pointer, they lead by 10. In the Big Eight, Oklahoma and Colorado, one-point lead for the Sooners. Right now, back to Sean and Derek.
Thank you, John. Near-capacity crowd on hand here at Fitzgerald Fieldhouse as the Panthers try to earn their second Big East Conference win of the year, their only other win at St. John's.
Boston College is trying to trap Pitt out of this defensive sequence, and Garrett Thomas is open so long that he really was unsure about whether to take the shot or not. He was able to cash it in, but, you know, just keep moving the ball, move without the ball. You'll get a chance for those opportunities. If Pitt is patient and allows the traps to occur, look for the diagonal pass.
Mail. The baseline. Thomas makes himself away from the basket. Aldridge, another three. He has 5 three-pointers, 15 points in all.
Andre Aldridge has been the show this evening for Pitt. By making those three-point shots, he's really opening up the inside, and the overplay defense by Boston College has created a lot of wide-open shots for himself and his teammates.
Chris Gant called for his second foul. Ralph Willard upset because his team's committing so many fouls, they're giving BC the chance to score points without the clock running. And these are two excellent free throw shooting teams. Pitt the best in the conference. So if BC resorts later to a strategy of foul and puts the Panthers on the line, not as likely to work against an excellent free throw shooting team like Pitt. 74% for the Panthers in conference. The lead is 12 as we tick down to 7 minutes remaining here in Pittsburgh. Keenan Jordan reached around to slap it out of bounds. 19 on the shot clock for Pittsburgh. Storyline tonight, the difference from three-point range. 9 more three-pointers for Pitt than for Boston College. That's 27 points from beyond the line. And when you lead by 12, that's been your big weapon.
Danny Abrams having a pretty good night, 25 points and 12 rebounds, but he certainly can't do it all by himself. He's got to get some support from the outside from Mark Malinsky. And, you know, certainly Bevan Thomas has to start looking for that outside shot to open up the inside.
Foul on Woodward, his second. Crowd with a mock cheer for the officials. Aware of the disparity in fouls here in the second half. Just the sixth called against BC. 6:45 remaining. Pitt by 12. Bear in mind, they have had some meltdowns this year when they've had leads in the second half. Thomas missed a three. The long rebound out to Aldridge and a fresh 35 on the shot clock with 6.5 minutes remaining.
It was an NBA launch by Garrick Thomas. He was about 4 or 5 steps behind the three-point line.
Gant, double team. And he traveled. Ralph Willard didn't like the call. Did a little hop, skip, and jump in front of his bench to indicate to Bob Donato that it wasn't a travel.
BC needs a lot more pressure like that. They need to take care of the ball first, try to get into their offensive front court and get some looks at the basket, but on the defensive end, continue with the pressure.
Grabowski, well short. Abrams there to follow. And the lead for Pitt is 10. You see, part of the problem for Dwayne Woodward in this game as well. He's so thin that when they do come to double team him, he's 6'3", and they list him at 160, and that's probably
wet.
Generous. He has a tough time fighting through. No problem for Antigua, making his way to the bucket. Lead back to 12. Antigua has 6 points.
All Pitt has to do is continue to be patient with the ball, and they can get easy shots inside.
Abrams the miss. Jordan too strong on the follow. Abrams took a technical. Abrams thought he was fouled as he went to the basket. And he said something to John Cowell and was teed up. And that's happened to Danier from time to time. He is known to voice his displeasure.
He's a young, emotional player. We talked about him only being a sophomore. Watch how number 24, Danier Abrams, gets the ball in his hands, and he's trying to get the shot up, and there was some contact on that. Twice he felt like he was fouled, and the technical foul was called because he actually swung his hand
back.
No,
it wasn't, because you could see John Cowell was still pointing up the floor and running up the floor. It was what he said.
Okay.
He goes fortunate to get away with the swing. Could have easily been called for that as well. I think he had a gripe on the shot. There was the swing and another. And now you see John Collins after he said something.
You're right.
He turned around and teed him up.
Absolutely right.
But he could have gotten it either way. Fortunate to get away with it the first time. This is the largest lead for Pitt. 14 points with 5:15 remaining.
BC still trying to pressure and allowing the deep man with the ball to get out, dribble out of that press. You can't do that if you're going to trap.
Chris Gant has been terrific tonight. 17 points in quiet fashion. And the Eagles will inbound. Under 5 minutes remaining now, and it's a 16-point edge for Pitt. Gant is 7 out of 8. From the floor. Women's basketball Friday at midnight Eastern time. Oregon State and Washington. A couple of top 25 teams. The Huskies led by All-American candidate Rhonda Smith. That's Friday night at midnight Eastern on ESPN. The women's game continues to grow in popularity. Woodward fouled as he went to dish off. Fouled by Aldridge. And that's 4 on Andre. He was not called for a foul in the first half. All 4 of them called here in the second half.
Sean, you did say the Lady Huskies were coming here?
Tomorrow night.
Should be a great
boy,
game.
Boy, they are awesome. 21-0. Oh, Rebecca Lobo and company. Husky Mania, the fever pitch. All-time high in Connecticut. Both teams now ranked number 1.
Watch out.
Woodward made the first free throw. Williams, the Iron Man, he played all 40 minutes in 4 of the last 7 games for BC. you think back to Howard Eisley, his freshman year with that talented nucleus. He averaged 34 minutes a game as a freshman. And BC fans should remember that the freshman year of Curley, Huckabee, Abram, and Eisley, BC went 1-15 in the conference. As seniors, they went to the Elite Eight. Third foul on Dwayne Woodward. Eighth on the team, still a 1-1.
It helps to keep that nucleus together so that players get to learn each other, be it a cut to the back door or just getting up the floor, playing defense, helping out your teammates. That's chemistry, and that's what you develop after being together, your graduating class, 2, 3, 4 years down the line.
Walridge at the line. Made the first. Mentioned that they're an excellent free throw shooting team, best in the Big East, and Walridge is a 76% free throw shooter. Came to Pitt as a walk-on, averaging 38 minutes a game. They're going to have a nice club last year. Ralph Will's got to put all the pieces together. They'll have so many new faces with the talented recruiting class you mentioned. Granger, a strong drive. Gerald Jordan sitting out the year as a transfer from Morgan State at 6'10". They think he'll be a contributor. You mentioned the coach's son, Kevin Willard, sitting out as a transfer from Western Kentucky. Jerry McCullough will be back from the knee. Chad Varga will be back from wrist surgery.
It's got a very bright future. One of the things I think that Andre Ulrich has to really be concerned about is his turnover ratio. He's averaging almost 5 turnovers a game, so certainly taking better care of the ball.
Great play by Jordan. The strip and the save, and Granger's shot was blocked. Under 4 minutes remaining, Pitt by 14. They don't need a quick three, and Mayo wisely passed it up. Then he was hacked across the arm on the pass off by Jordan. That's the 19th foul, so still a 1-1. And the first foul against Keenan Jordan.
His first, the team's 9th.
Obviously, she's a freshman.
Jason Mayo to the line to shoot the 1-1.
And Mayo will shoot it. Pitt's 11 out of 12 from the line tonight. They've been outstanding from the free throw line and the three-point line. Mayo was absolutely the wrong guy to foul, 78% from the line. And 3 out of 4 from the stripe tonight.
I'd say Ralph Willard does have a definite upside to the future of this basketball program, especially with the talk of a new facility, new basketball facility down the road.
He hopes that they'll have a new 12,000-seat arena on campus here by 1998. Paul Grant, a strong follow, and he was so strong, he bent the rim.
Got a timeout.
So we can make some money on the Total Sports Network. Pitt by 12 here in Pittsburgh.
Hey, early again, huh, Frank?
I don't say this to many people. What we do, the job we do.
Okay, guys, listen up.
It's the most important job I can think of.
You've got a flight control check. Lewis and Randall.
I mean, there's no such thing as a B-plus mechanic on this airline.
Let's do it. Let's go.
Everybody knows their job. Everybody's responsible. Anybody, right down to the most junior mechanic, can keep an airplane in this hangar if there's the slightest hint of a problem. You might think, doing a job like this, day in, day out, it'd become routine. You know, just turning wrenches. But every now and then, I just go up and take a walk through the terminal. And right there, right in front of you, you see what's important.
During the Dodge Preferred Option Sale, pick your options, pick your cash savings and values, like up to $1,747 off the car that changed everything, Dodge Intrepid and Intrepid ES. Consumers Digest 95 Best Buys, including cash savings that can be sent factory direct to you or use them toward your down payment. The Dodge Preferred Option Sale. The more you want, the more you save. See the friendly Dodge dealer near you.
Following the game on SportsCenter in the SEC, Arkansas tries to avoid the sweep against Alabama. Shaq and the Magic take on the Cavs in Cleveland, and the Rangers go up against the Sabres in a low-scoring affair. That's on SportsCenter.
There's Kevin Willard, son of Coach Ralph Willard, sitting out as a transfer from Western Kentucky. When his dad left, Kevin came with him, as you could understand. They apply for a waiver to waive the NCAA rule about sitting out for a year under the circumstances. The NCAA said nope. He sits on a 3-2 vote. Peterson couldn't handle the pass on the end line. He was out of bounds once he did get his hands on it. So BC will inbound down 12 with 3:19 remaining. Early in the year, Digger Phelps suggested on one of our telecasts, the NCAA needs a person who's the commissioner or vice president in charge of common sense. And when the coach leaves and a young man like Kevin Willard got death threats in a small town like Bowling Green, Kentucky, because his father was very popular, rejuvenated that program. He leaves. The folks were angry that he left. Some were angry, some understood. Now all of a sudden, it's miserable for Kevin. But the NCAA says, we'll let you transfer, but you have to sit out. I mean, why not let the young man go with the son, and why force him to sit out for you?
I don't understand that. I don't think Digger was the one who thought about that. Several people before him have probably made similar comments about the NCAA need to have a little more compassion for the student athlete, especially a kid who wants to follow his son to another school. Follow his dad to another school.
Of course, all of our analysts, including yourself, have many original thoughts. That might not have been one. Well, here's some thoughts from Dick Vitale on Up Close with Chris Myers.
And we're looking forward to that. What do you think in a half-hour show is the over-under for the number of questions Chris will manage to sneak in between Dick's monologues? I say three, about a question
I
every 10 minutes.
I guess two good ones.
Malinsky couldn't handle the high pass from Granger. 16 turnovers, and that's below the average in Big East play for Jim O'Brien. But tonight he's being undone by the three-point shooting of the Pitt Panthers. They lead by 12 with 3 minutes remaining.
So Daniel Abrams is playing a great game, but he's not getting support from his teammates.
I mean, just when you think he can't possibly match what he's done of late, look at this. Surpassing his rebounding total the last three games. And two more points for 20. If he gets 29 again tonight, that would be amazing, wouldn't it?
I think you can almost set your clock to him. Just put him out on the floor. Give him 29 points and 11 rebounds.
Sit on the bench. Say, yeah. All right, give him 29. We'll start to hit 29-0. We'll play 4-5. Thomas, rather Antigua, missed the first. Orlando, honored by the United States Basketball Writers Association at the Final Four last year as the most courageous player in the country. Played his first 2 years at Pitt with a bullet lodged behind his left ear. He had that bullet there for nearly 5 years. Innocent bystander hitting a drive-by shooting. That's five on Danier Abrams, and the technical really hurt him because that counts on the personal total. He's taking the ball with him, and he's going to hand it to Mike Kitts and not John Call. He's lucky that wasn't another technical.
I know. He's already on his way out of the game.
And Paul Grant heads in. Vanier, really a likable young guy, and I think he was unfairly tarnished by what happened in the NCAA tournament last year. He committed a hard foul in the upset win over North Carolina against Derek Phelps. Dean Smith made a major issue about it. Labeled it dirty, Danier shakes John Call's hand, which is probably on the instruction of the coaching staff. I don't think Dean Smith was as gracious in defeat as he should have been that day. He really overshadowed a wonderful moment for a BC team by putting so much emphasis on a hard foul.
Right.
It was hard, but he was trying to stop an uncontested layup. And now he's fighting the stigmas, Danier, about being a dirty player, because that's been put on him.
But, Sean, remember the foul that was committed that should not have been charged at Danier?
Right. That put him fouled out of the game.
Yes, it did.
That was really a terrible call. 14-point lead, 2:50 remaining. Danier leaves with 27 points. An 8 of 12 from the field, 11 of 14 from the free throw line. Paul Grant the stuff.
Paul Grant's come in and give a couple of high percentage shots by looking down inside the basket.
Full court pressure, Woodward. Malinsky a three, short. There's Jordan, and he's fouled. So they have it down to 12. And the hustle by Woodward creates free throws for Keaton Jordan.
BC is not going to go away. They still think they have a chance to get back in this game by playing aggressive on the defensive end. You come up with a steal, a loose ball, get a basket here, basket there, but you have to play defense from end to end and not allow Pitt to get easy backdoor layups.
Charge to number four, Garrick Thomas, his fifth.
Garrick Thomas has now fouled out. So Ralph Willard will take advantage of the time he is allotted, huddle his troops, and off the substitute for Garrick Thomas. He's in the huddle, but he cannot continue. For those of you who joined us recently, this is a look back at the foul to which Derek was referring early in the second half. This was called an offensive foul by Mike Kitts. He pointed emphatically in the other direction. They headed the other way, but he held up 2-4. It was as if he got confused. Then when he couldn't figure out who the foul was on, he changed it to a foul on Danier Abrams. And that was one of his five toward disqualification. The music means one thing, basketball. Tomorrow night, triple header, Clemson, North Carolina. Arizona, USC, Arizona State, and UCLA, a triple header. Four of the top 13 teams in the country in action tomorrow night. Keenan Jordan made the first. So BC will try to come back from 11 down now without their best player, Danier Abrams. He was fouled out for the third time this year. Jordan missed the second. Charged after his rebound, which was corralled by Gant. Antigua. And now they look to run some time. And Gant got a hand on the pass. 22 on the shot clock, 2:13 in the game. Pitt by 11.
Pitt does not have to look to score. All they have to do is keep moving the ball, get to the open space, and hit the man. That's very simple, basic basketball. And when the double team occurs, pick up your dribble, try to get the ball to the middle of the court.
BC looking to play defense and trying to stop on this possession, but they might have to foul in ensuing possessions. They got the turnover that time, but Pitt ran 27 seconds off the clock and got it under 2 minutes. Leading by 11. Ralph Willard earlier this year saw a 6-point lead with 50 seconds left against Villanova evaporate and wind up as an overtime loss. Malinsky, the runner, too strong. Granger swatted by Peterson. Woodward kicked it out. Nice save by Malinsky. Jordan, Woodward, baseline attack. I believe it was Gant who will be called for the foul. Coming up immediately following tonight's game, SportsCenter with Keith Olbermann and Dan Patrick. They'll update you on the top 25 SEC battle, Arkansas and Alabama. The Magic playing the Cavs tonight. And they'll tell you what happened in the NFL expansion draft today as Carolina and Jacksonville made their picks off the other NFL team rosters.
It's always fun to watch an expansion draft because it opened up so many more jobs for other players, guys who have been borderline players for the NFL or the Canadian League.
Woodward made the first to get it down to 10. He's bettered his average of 5.8 with 7 points tonight. Well, they have it in the single digits. Minute 37 left. Derek, would you agree that now if they don't get a quick steal, they need to go to the fouls rather than letting...
Right away, yes. Get. Good call. Right away. You don't want any more time to click off the clock, and you certainly don't have time to start deciding who's the best or who's the worst free throw shooter out there.
Antonio Granger called for the foul. Just his second. Minute 34 left, Pitt by 9. Panthers looking for their second conference win, trying to go to 2-11, and a defeat would drop Boston College to 2-11. They'd be tied in the basement of the Big East, which is expanding to 13 teams next year with the additions of Notre Dame, Rutgers, and West Virginia. The presidents and athletic directors have decided that it'll be one 13-team conference. They won't have divisions, and both of these coaches favored divisional play, and most of the coaches we've talked to in the Big East favored dividing up the teams. Aldridge made both. He's perfect from the line tonight and having a terrific night. 21 points, six shy of his career best. Woodward, strong drive, fouled by Gant. And that's four on Chris Gant.
Dwayne Woodward showing some experience as the season progresses. He is only a freshman, but as he plays a lot of minutes, 32 minutes a game, he is now starting to show some of that experience, how to get to the free throw line, how to make things happen. But in this situation, you need points. You need points in bunches if you can. Get some penetration and pitch it back out. Look for Malinsky on the perimeter.
Woodward upset himself as he missed the first. Still an 11-point game. His first miss from the line tonight. And that's his second. The ball hit the floor. Paul Grant short with it. But BC will inbound.
Grant wasn't able to come up cleanly with that ball. He actually hit the bottom of the rim, but he was able to manage possession.
Pitt's done a terrific job tonight of denying Malinsky three-point opportunities. Jordan missed a long three, rebounded by Gant. And Pitt is inching closer to the win. Snap at five-game losing streak. They had lost 10 of 11 coming in. We mentioned the last loss. Really the only time this year they've really been throttled. 90-61 at Connecticut. Ralph Willett said his team was tired. You can understand that, the way they play, the trapping style, and with only seven scholarship players. He said, when they went into the nine-day break, he told his team, we're going to have 9 days between games. I'm going to give you 3 days off, but we're going to do something together as a team and have some fun. We haven't had much fun. Mm. You have two choices, bowling or skydiving. I think Ralph is distraught as he wanted to go skydiving. The team chose bowling, and sure enough, they went on a team bowling outing, and Coach Willard's team won. They divide up into four-person teams. He had Chad Varga, Chris Gant, and Charles Thompson on his squad. He said they won even though Varga, who's out with the wrist surgery, had to bowl left-handed because of that wrist surgery. He's naturally right-handed.
It's amazing. He still keeps a great sense of humor about himself. His team is 5-15, about to go 6-15, but he wants these kids to continue to learn his philosophy so they can be a better team in the future.
Granger knocked one in, and Jim O'Brien uses a timeout with 51 seconds left. He's down by 11. Ralph Willard eyeing his second Big East win.
We looked. We listened. We challenged all conventional thinking. We reconsidered every facet of car design, every nuance of engineering. And at every turn, we not only asked why, we asked why not. New Dodge Stratus. We questioned everything.
ESPN's NCAA Basketball, brought to you by Beechwood-aged Budweiser. It's always been true, this Bud's for you. And by Dodge. The more things change, the more things look like the new Dodge.
As soon as we're finished here in Pittsburgh, Sports Center comes your way. 51 seconds remaining. Pitt leads by 11. And the Panthers in possession of the ball. Chris Gant to inbound. He threw it along the baseline to Antigua. They get it to Mayo. Good idea with his free throw shooting ability. Granger and Malinsky came to him immediately. Only 3 seconds went off the clock. And I believe it was Granger. It was called for the foul. His third.
The team is over the limit. Jason Mayo. Go to the line to shoot two.
The Big East. UConn trying to run through the conference undefeated. It'll be the first time in the 15-year history of this league that that has happened.
had a chance to watch Missouri blow through the Big 8 last year, undefeated for the first time in quite a while. So there is some good basketball out there, and we'll see if UConn can continue in postseason play. That's going to be very important to see if they can be consistent and win some games against some other top-notch opponents around the country.
Mail, 17 points tonight. And this one appears to be comfortably in the win column now for Pitt. Even more comfortably as Peterson took it away from Woodward. Antigua. And a foul, Orlando. Woodward with a shove in the chest. His fourth. We mentioned a moment ago, and it got lost in the disqualification of Abrams. Antigua won the Most Courageous Player Award in the country last year. That's an annual award given out at the Final Four by the U.S. Basketball Writers Association. He had the bullet lodged behind his ear for 5 years. They finally had to take it out when he got headaches. But he also won that award for his leadership in his family. For a while, when he was in high school, his family was homeless. He was the oldest of three boys. It was just the three boys and his mother. And Orlando led them through that situation. Things are better for the family now. One of his younger brothers, we mentioned, Oliver, a manager on the team and plays time to time as a walk-on. Another brother, Omar, is a freshman here in Pittsburgh at Carnegie Mellon. He's 6'4", plays the 2 and 3. Granger, they let him have the open shot, and he missed it. Grant tipped it in. But it's too late for Boston College. Pittsburgh will split the regular season series with BC with this win. They'll have identical records in the conference of 2-11. Peterson. He's done it with a quiet night from Jaime. Three-point shooting, the key factor tonight. Pitt did an excellent job hitting them and an excellent job defending. Walensky count that one at the buzzer. And that accounts for the final margin. Pitt 84, Boston College 75. Keith and Dan standing by with the top 25 battle from the SEC, among other stories. For Derek Dickey, shot...